Hello everyone, welcome to Pepsha's YouTube channel. So in this video we'll see a short trick to draw graph of inverse functions. So drawing graph of inverse functions is pretty useful kyunki functions ke questions mein, inverse trigonometry ke questions mein kai baar aapko inverse functions ka graph draw karna hota hai. And the standard technique to do that is take reflection about y is equal to x. So we'll see a short trick without using reflection about y is equal to x, how can we draw the graph? And the reason is that y is equal to x about reflection is not very convenient, and it is not always possible to visualize ki what will the process look like when we do reflection about y is equal to x. And kai baar hum graph itni easy se draw nahi kar pate in one stroke. So we'll see how we can do that and using an alternative way, and we'll use complex numbers to understand that. So basically we'll use geometry of complex numbers to understand how we can draw graph of inverse functions. And in this video I'll take example of all inverse trigonometric functions and draw the graph and show how we can apply the trick. So first we'll see what the standard technique is. The standard technique is that if you have a graph, if you have a function y is equal to fx, and you want to draw the graph of y is equal to f inverse x. So what happens is, let's say you have a point x comma y. So what happens is that that means that when you put x in the function, you get y. So inverse function means that when you put y, for what value x did you get y, right? So for example, that what that means is, let's say that you have x and y, which means that if I take function of x, I get y. So if I need to find y is equal to f inverse x, that means that I will put y and I'll get back x. So if there was a point x comma y on the graph of y is equal to fx, there will be a point y comma x on the graph of y is equal to f inverse x. You can think of it this way, that if there is a point a comma b, that means that if I put a in the function, I get back b. So that means if I take inverse I take the inverse function and put b, I'll get back a, which means that this, if this graph has a point a comma b, then this graph has a point b comma a, right? So for every point a comma b, there will be a point b comma a. That means you can take reflection about y is equal to x, because for any point a comma b, the reflection about y is equal to x gives the point b comma a. So as we saw that because for any point a comma b, there will be a point b comma a on the graph. So taking reflection will give us the graph itself, explicitly give us the graph of the inverse trigonometric function, right? So again, as you might have noticed, ki doing this is not always possible. For example, let's say you have this kind of graph, right? This is the graph, and I say you take reflection about y is equal to x. Now this is not very easy to do, right? And if you try to take the reflection, it is very difficult that you can draw with hand what the graph and what the function will look like. So what is the alternative way to do it? So to do that, we'll have to use complex numbers, and we'll just see a few properties. So let's say you have a point x comma y, so that can equivalently be represented by complex number x plus iota y. So if you take the complex plane, then a point x comma y is equivalent to a complex number x plus I y. If you take a point x comma y, let's say which is here x comma y, and you take the reflection about the x-axis, so this is the x-axis. So if you take reflection about x-axis, the x-coordinate remains same because it is on the same vertical line, and the y-coordinate becomes negative. So that means if I take x comma minus y, that will become x minus iota y, right? And if I multiply by iota, so if I multiply a complex number by iota, what happens is it gets rotated by 90 degrees. So if I multiply by iota, what happens is this complex number will get rotated by 90 degrees, which means that if I multiply iota on x plus iota y, I will get a point iota x plus iota x minus y, which means a point minus y comma x, and this point is at the same distance from the origin but rotated by 90 degrees. So why is all this useful? We'll see that. So what I'm claiming is, let's say you have a point x comma y, right? So which means you have a point x comma y, and you have to go to the point y comma x. So hum ek tarika dhoondna hai complex numbers ke through ki hum x comma y se y comma x kaise jaye. So I give a path, I say ki tum reflection karo, yani ki usko let's say you have x plus iota y. So if you do reflection about the x axis, what you'll get, you'll get x minus iota y. Then what you do, then you take the rotation by 90 degrees, so multiply by 90. So this was reflection about the x axis, reflection about x axis, and this was rotation by 90 degree clockwise, right? So iota का मतलब clockwise rotation होता है, sorry anti-clockwise rotation होता है. So this is anti-clockwise rotation, right? So for example, करा क्या हमने, हमारे पास एक x plus iota y, पहले इसको हमने x minus iota y करा, मतलब x axis के बाद rotate करा, और फिर इस vector को 90 degree हमने क्या करा, move करा, तो ये vector कहीं यहाँ चला जाएगा. तो तुम देख सकते हो इस vector का इस line के about वो हो गया. तो I'll show this in more details. When you multiply this by iota, what you get is iota x plus y, right? Iota times minus iota will become 1. So you get iota x plus y, and this is the coordinate of this complex number is y comma x. So by few steps, we have gone from x comma y to y comma x, and I'll show that in detail, the point we were discussing right now. So what we were saying was, let's say you have a vector. Let's say you have a vector on the coordinate plane, which is this, and you want to take reflection about y is equal to x. So standard technique would be to take the line y is equal to x and take the reflection about it, and you'll get this point, right? If this line is y is equal to x, so this, if this point is a comma b, this will be b comma a. So I'm giving you an alternative way to do it. I'm saying that first take reflection about the x axis. So first take reflection about the x axis, and you get the point a comma minus b. And then you can see that if you rotate this by 90 degree, we have proved by complex numbers that if you rotate this by 90 degree, these two will make an angle 90 degree. So first take reflection, then do rotation. So how does this help us making graphs? So the process is, let's say you have a graph. So for example, let's take y is equal to sine x, and you have to draw the graph of y is equal to sine inverse x. So this is an example just to show how we can use these properties to do what we just discussed. So let's say you have the graph of sine x, and we will draw the graph just in minus pi by 2 to pi by 2. So the graph looks something like this, right? So this point is pi by 2. In this case, it might be straightforward to do it even about reflection about y is equal to x, but in later cases, we see it is not very easy to do that reflection. So we'll use this technique. So what was the first process? The first thing was to do reflection about the x-axis. So treat this x-axis as a mirror and do reflection, and this is very easy to do because you just have to flip it, right? So when we do reflection, this thing gets flipped, so you get something like this, and this part also gets flipped, so you get something like this. So when you do the reflection, you will get another graph which looks something like this, right? So it looks something like this. I'll draw it again. Which looks something like this. Now the next thing to do is rotate it anti-clockwise by 90 degree, which means that you take this graph and rotate it by 90 degree. Now this might be a little cumbersome. So another easier way to do it, either you rotate the graph by 90 degree anti-clockwise, or you rotate yourself by 90 degree clockwise, right? So now you are seeing this graph from here, right? When you see this graph from here, this is the first quadrant, this is the second quadrant, this is the second quadrant, this is the third quadrant, and this is the fourth quadrant. So either you can rotate a graph by 90 degree anti-clockwise, or you can rotate yourself by 90 degree clockwise, which means now you start rotating yourself this way. So either you rotate the graph or you rotate yourself. So if you rotate the graph 90 degree anti-clockwise, it is equivalent to saying that rotate your body or your head 90 degree clockwise. So now you see it from here, right? So which means that this fourth quadrant now becomes the first quadrant. This first quadrant now becomes the second quadrant. This third quadrant now becomes the second quadrant now becomes the third quadrant, and this third quadrant becomes the fourth quadrant, right? So what I mean is that if you see the graph tilting your head in 90 degree clockwise, you will see a new graph, right? The coordinates will change. So what I said was that you had this graph which looked like this, and you're seeing the graph from here, right? Now if you draw the graph, if somebody from there sees the graph, he will see the graph as this, right? If you see the graph from here, this will become the first quadrant. So this is the first quadrant. This will become the second quadrant. This is the second quadrant. It says nothing. This will become the third quadrant. This is the third quadrant. And again, this will become the fourth quadrant. So this is the fourth quadrant, right? We're seeing it from here. So put your you have to make your eyes here and see it. This is the downside of the graph. So if you see the graph from here, then you will look at this. So the process is, first take the reflection about the x-axis, which is easy, and then tilt yourself and see the graph, and you will be able to see, you will get an equivalent way to draw y is equal to f inverse x. So let's take another example. We'll draw all the functions. So we have y is equal to cos x, and we have to draw y is equal to cos inverse of x, right? So what we do is first we draw cos x. So first we draw cos x. So cos x in 0 to, we'll draw it in 0 to pi by 2. Sorry, 0 to pi. So this is pi. So this is how it looks. So the first step is to take reflection about the x-axis. So that is pretty easy. So that looks something like this. Now what we have to do is we have to see the graph from here. So when you see the graph from here, how does it look like? This becomes the first coordinate. So you have this portion of the graph which you have to draw in the first quadrant, and this becomes the second quadrant. So you have to draw this portion of the graph in the second quadrant. So it looks something like this. So we'll take a few other examples. So let's say we have y is equal to tan x, and you can try them on your own. I think now you must have got the hang of what we are doing, and you have understood why this works. So tan x looks something like this, right? Again, we'll draw it in minus pi by 2 to pi by 2. And the reason is that that is the principal domain of the inverse trigonometric function. So if you have read inverse trigonometry, you'll know. So now what we have to do, we have to draw the reflection of, about y is equal to x, and we'll do it using the alternative way. So if we did it by the standard way, we'll have to take reflection about this line. So you can see it is not a very convenient thing to do. Instead, what we'll do, first reflect it about the x-axis. So when you reflect it about this axis, so think of it as a mirror, and doing that is pretty easy because it is something which we're used to doing, and then you get something like this, right? Now you see the graph from here. So when you see the graph from here, I'll draw it in a separate line. I'll draw it on a new with a new like new color. So first we took the reflection, right? So this is the reflection. So you can see that this thing is the reflection, and then we are seeing it from here. So the graph you'll get will look like, so this is the thing we'll have to draw in the first quadrant, and this is the thing we'll have to draw in the second quadrant. So when you split it yourself, this will become your first quadrant, this will become your second quadrant, this will become third quadrant, and this will become fourth quadrant. So in the first quadrant you have something like this, and in the third quadrant you'll have something like this. So if you tilt yourself, you'll be able to see why I'm doing this. So this is y is equal to tan. And now we'll see the ones in which taking reflection about y is equal to x is not straightforward. For example, when you have to draw the graph is equal of cosec inverse x or sec inverse x. So for example, you have y is equal to cosec x, and you want to draw the graph of sec inverse x or cosec inverse x. So I'll change the color again. And the graph looks something like this. Again, we'll draw it in minus pi by 2 to pi by 2. So it looks something like this. Now you can see that taking a reflection about this line is not a very easy thing to do, right? It is very cumbersome, and you have to be very accurate while doing it. So in this method, what we have to do is we don't have to worry about any such thing. So what we'll have to do is we'll first take reflection about the x-axis, right? So think of this as the mirror and take reflection. So that is very easy to do, right? So this line is pi by 2 and this line is minus pi by 2. So when you take a reflection, so this becomes something like this, and when you take a reflection here, it becomes something like this. Now see the graph from here. So when you see the graph from here, this is the first quadrant and this is the third quadrant, and you can draw the graph, tilt your phone or tilt yourself, and you can see that the graph looks something like this. So if you tilt yourself and see, you'll see that the graph looks something like this. And this is indeed the graph of y is equal to cosec inverse x. So you can do other examples as well. So I'll take a last example, but you can do many examples or draw in general any inverse function graph. So let's say we have y is equal to sec x, and we have to draw the function or like graph of y is equal to sec inverse x, right? So I'll draw the graph first. So let's say we have this graph. So for sec x, the graphs look something like this. So in 0 to pi, we have to draw it. So it looks something like this. So this is pi and this is pi by 2. So you can see that if I say take reflection about this line, it's not very convenient to take, right? And even I am making a mistake while drawing this line, and you have to be very accurate. So now if you use this method, what you have to do is first take reflection about the x-axis and then tilt yourself and make the graph. So we'll do that. So when you take reflection about this axis, right, what happens is So what happens is you take reflection. So this is the mirror. So it looks something like this. Now if you see from here, the graph will be right. This becomes the first quadrant and this is the second quadrant. So the graph is something like this. So this is the graph of y is equal to second verse x. So I hope you learned something new, and now you know a better way to draw graphs and you have an intuition of why this method works too. So if you like the video, you can subscribe to the channel, and if you have any ideas or any topics you find it tricky, or you want to know some other short tricks of concepts you find difficult or lengthy, so you can let us know about it in the comment section. And if you have any other review or any other suggestion about the channel, you can also write that. And we'll see you next time.